One more. Good morning. Let me see. I was waiting for. All right. Hi, Farouk. Good morning. How are you?
Feeling good, feeling good. Let's do this. Oh,
Yeah. Rainy morning here in Philadelphia. So, welcome everybody to our Penn Radiology Global Health Imaging Case Competition. This is the third Latin American round. And Farouk, why don't you get us started and then I'll do the introduction of our keynote speaker.
it's amazing that we've been able to get this far, with this team. And I think for those tuning in, you're going to be as impressed with the cases that we have today as usual. So same format, about 20 cases. We're going to start off with a keynote speaker. And without further ado, I'm going to let Hansel go ahead and get us started.
I always forget at the end because I feel rushed to let people go back to lunch or stuff. But we do want to thank the Penn Center for Global Health for the support, for the technical support, for letting us have Alejo help us with the organization. And of course, the Department of Radiology at Penn Medicine that is funding the competition. And most of the rest of the team is sitting here at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, where everyone is welcome. So today, I'm very happy to introduce the keynote speaker because he's a good friend, Dr. Lina Cadavid from Medellin. She is leading an amazing campaign on radiation protection, something that we haven't seen that much until now in Latin America. And she's organizing a great effort to create conscience about around the fact that we shouldn't be radiating children. So anyway, I'm gonna let you hear her experience on working on this very heterogeneous or around the continent with this new campaign that I think is really exciting. So thank you, Lina, for being with us. We know that it's an hour earlier back home, so you woke up really early for this. And please educate us.
Thank you for invitation. Bueno, vamos a dar creo que la clase, sí, en español para este concurso maravilloso. Y es algo muy corto, una introducción, digamos, una invitación para todos los asistentes que nos están viendo y están compitiendo el día de hoy. Así que voy a compartir mi pantalla. Hansel me comprueba si está funcionando bien. ¿Se ve bien?
Sí, perfecto. Perfecto.
Listo, perfecto. Entonces, digamos que esto es una pequeña invitación a toda Latinoamérica y bueno, y a nivel mundial que nos unamos a Irradiar Conciencia. Irradiar Conciencia es una campaña que organizamos a nivel de la Sociedad Latinoamericana de Radiología Pediátrica para hacer una campaña de tomografía de baja dosis de radiación. ¿Y por qué? ¿Por qué la creamos? Porque es importante pensar en nuestros pacientes pediátricos. Es importante que creemos conciencia, que nos evaluemos, que miremos cómo está toda Latinoamérica en relación a la radiación, que sepamos si sabemos sobre radiación, si sabemos que los pacientes pediátricos son más radiosensibles. Entonces, dijimos, vamos a pensarla bien, vamos a crear unos tips pequeños para que todos hagamos muy bien nuestro trabajo, hablemos nuestro idioma completamente y lo hagamos bien por nuestros niños latinoamericanos. Así que creamos esta campaña. Sabemos que mucha gente, a pesar de que trabajamos con radiación, no la conocemos a profundidad, no es un tema difícil, no es algo engorroso. Lo importante es digamos, entenderlo y entenderlo de forma muy fácil y práctica. ¿De dónde salió la inspiración para esta campaña? Pues sabemos que la inspiración son nuestros niños, pero en realidad en la parte médica hay varios artículos muy interesantes como este que está publicado en Lancet, que fue en el 2012, donde es un estudio que hicieron en Inglaterra con muchos pacientes pediátricos y adolescentes, y ellos encontraron en este grupo de pacientes 74 leucemias, pacientes que fueron obviamente a tomografía, y de este otro grupo de 176.587 encontraron 135 tumores del sistema nervioso central que se atribuyó que podía ser por la radiación. Entonces nos hicieron unas conclusiones muy interesantes. Recordemos que la radiación es acumulativa y digamos que el común denominador para estos pacientes que encontraron cáncer era que una dosis acumulada por encima de 50 miligrays o milisieverts nos podía dar tumores de sistema nervioso central o por encima de 60 tumores, perdón, por encima de 50 tumores de sistema nervioso central y por encima de 60 tumores de médula ósea. Entonces, importante saber cómo tener en cuenta esas dosis de radiación. Sabemos las dosis acumuladas por las bombas atómicas, pero no teníamos como estudios clínicos bien detallados que nos ayudaran para esto. Entonces, de ahí la inspiración. Más artículos recientes del 2023, este que fue publicado en un journal de Canadá, en donde nos hablan que pacientes por encima de 4 tomografías, sobre todo en el grupo de menores de 6 años, tienen un riesgo importante de tener un cáncer, ya sea linfoma, leucemia o de sistema nervioso central, en relación a la radiación. Entonces, digamos que de acá, de todos estos artículos, nos inspiramos. Y uno más reciente, que fue realizado en Europa también en el 2023, con 9 países, se llama EPCT, es un estudio en pacientes en menores de 22 años, un grupo muy grande de pacientes, en los cuales ellos concluyen que al menos uno a dos niños entre 10.000 van a desarrollar una neoplasia de médula ósea en los primeros 12 años de vida. Entonces, digamos que todo esto nos alarma y nos dice, bueno, sepamos de radiación, hagamos las cosas muy bien, sin temor, pero que esté bien justificado, y de aquí la inspiración. Importante que siempre justifiquemos y optimicemos la dosis en nuestros pacientes pediátricos para realizar bien nuestro trabajo. Pero hubo un detonante, obviamente a pesar de la inspiración hay detonantes, y fue este artículo que publicamos en Pediatric Radiology este año. Aquí tienen el código QR si lo quieren obtener. Es un estudio que se hizo en Latinoamérica, 8 países, 12 instituciones, 3.934 pacientes, en los cuales intentamos hacer niveles de referencia de dosis de tomografía de cráneo, tórax y abdomen en pediatría, y nos dimos cuenta que en realidad nuestras dosis estaban un poco más elevadas comparando con las dosis reportadas en Europa en el 2018 y más recientemente reportadas en Radiology de Estados Unidos en el 2021. Esto es una gráfica de tomografía de cráneo en el cual estos son los pacientes latinos y en azul más claro los pacientes de Estados Unidos, simplemente comparándonos, y nuestras dosis están un poco más elevadas, sobre todo en los pacientes más pequeños. Entonces dijimos, bueno, quizás, obviamente no sabemos cuál es la dosis ideal, ¿cierto? No sabemos cuál es la menor dosis que debemos utilizar o cuál es la mayor, pero sí es importante que al compararnos estemos muy similares, así que si estamos por encima, pues es llamativo. Y por eso creamos esta campaña de irradiar conciencia. Nos unimos varias entidades, entre ellas LatinSafe, el Colegio Brasilero de Radiología, Imagine Genti, que nos ayudó bastante, y creamos estos 12 tips que enseguida se los voy a mostrar, y hablamos con el resto de las sociedades de radiología de toda Latinoamérica para que nos apoyaran, para que lanzáramos en octubre esta campaña por todas las redes sociales, por todos los canales, y así poder crear esa conciencia que queremos y que mejoremos esas dosis para poder volver a publicar. Esta es la campaña que más enseguida se las voy a mostrar. Están en todas nuestras redes de la Sociedad Latinoamericana de Radiología Pediátrica. Nos pueden encontrar en X, en Facebook, en YouTube, en Instagram y publicamos esto en octubre. ¿Cuál fue la idea de la campaña? Ustedes están viendo, la idea es con el icono de radiación a nivel universal que estuviera presente y en el centro de ese icono tener imágenes alusivas a los niños, no tener imágenes como tal fotografías de niños ni de médicos para que no se centrara la visión sobre esas imágenes, sino realmente sobre las frases que ya más adelante las vamos a ver y que estuviera ese icono representado como para que sepamos de qué estamos hablando, de qué estamos hablando es de protección radiológica. La pusimos con colores obviamente alegres y están en todos nuestros canales y en nuestra página de internet. La pueden descargar sin ningún problema en español, en inglés, si lo quieren tener ahí, si quieren incentivar a los estudiantes, a los residentes, a los tecnólogos, que es muy importante y es una campaña que no es solo para la gente de radiología, sino que es muy importante que la tengan los pediatras, los clínicos, con los cuales ellos también deben saber sobre el tema de radiación y les debemos crear esa conciencia a ellos. Entonces creamos estos 12 tips de irradiemos conciencia. ¿Cuál es el primer tip? Es muy sencillo, es escanear el área indicada una sola vez, es decir, si estamos hablando de tag de cuello, es tag de cuello, no incluir más allá del cráneo ni del tórax, si estamos hablando de una tomografía de abdomen y pelvis, obviamente no nos tenemos que extender mucho, o sea, ubicarnos bien en el área indicada, colimar muy bien nuestros pacientes y evitar, obviamente, radiación dispersa. El tip número dos es usar una imagen alternativa sin radiación ionizante. Claro, siempre debemos pensar, o sea, digamos que la idea no es que todo sea automático en nuestros servicios, sino que si llega un paciente con una orden, pensar, ¿será que es mejor una ecografía? ¿Será mejor una resonancia? ¿O definitivamente es la tomografía la indicada? Mirar los estudios previos del paciente. Recordemos que la dosis de radiación es acumulativa. Entonces, quizás es un paciente que ya lo hemos irradiado mucho y que podemos hacerle control con otros métodos que no tengan radiación o definitivamente está bien justificado y tocó, entonces podemos bajar más la dosis, colimar, quizás no tengamos que explorar todo el tórax, sino solo las bases pulmonares porque ahí está su patología, o sea, siempre pensar en optimizar y justificar la dosis de radiación. El tercer tips es una sola fase suficiente, siempre he dicho que este es de mis favoritos. ¿Por qué? Porque la mayoría de las indicaciones de tomografía en pediatría es suficiente con una fase, inclusive en trauma abdominal, por ejemplo. Si el paciente no tiene un trauma renal, si el paciente no está inestable, no tiene una fractura complicada, no necesitamos hacer fase arterial en pelvis, por ejemplo, o no necesitamos hacer eliminación renal. Con una fase venosa sería suficiente. Entonces, siempre pensar en eso, estar pendiente del paciente, de la indicación. Las fases simples son prácticamente inútiles en pediatría y las fases tardías también. Entonces, justificar una sola fase, a veces podemos utilizar doble bolo, que esto nos ayuda mucho, por ejemplo, en pacientes trasplantados, y así hacemos un solo barrido, una sola fase es suficiente. El cuarto tip es utilice MAS modulado, es muy importante, hay una en todos nuestros tomógrafos, que la mayoría de Latinoamérica realmente nos hemos dado cuenta, tenemos muy buena tecnología de última generación, entonces utilicemos el modulador automático de exposición de dosis, dejemos que el equipo, o sea, utilicemos todas las herramientas que tiene el equipo para bajar dosis de radiación, ¿cierto?, para modular la dosis, y dejemos que el miliamperaje sea modulado por el equipo, y el kilovoltaje, que sí es el que vamos a hablar más adelante, lo vamos a tener fijo y de bajo valor. El quinto tips es optimice los protocolos de tomografía basados en parámetros pediátricos y en la región anatómica de interés. Esto es algo en lo cual estamos trabajando. Hay muchos, ustedes pueden utilizar todos, digamos, los miliamperajes, los kilovoltajes que traen ya los equipos establecidos para pediatría, pero ojalá es optimizarlos, bajarlos un poco más, o utilizarlos basados en el peso del paciente, en la edad del paciente, en el diámetro efectivo. Y lo ideal, lo que se está trabajando en la actualidad, es que utilicemos todos estos parámetros, lo mismo que las fases de tomografía, basados en la indicación clínica. Basados en la indicación, poder utilizar y optimizar todos estos parámetros. Esto nos pueden ayudar los aplicacionistas, nuestros tecnólogos, revisar la literatura que hay, y es muy fácil hacer este tip. El sexto, como les había hablado ahorita, el kilovoltaje, estamos haciendo una sugerencia de que sea lo más bajo posible, entre 70 y 100, para la mayoría de nuestros estudios en pediatría, de cráneo, cuello, tórax y abdomen, y ojalá que sea fijo, que es un tip que más adelante lo tenemos también establecido. El número 7 es use una reconstrucción interactiva, o sea, utilicemos todas las herramientas que tienen nuestros tomógrafos para disminuir el ruido, para disminuir la dosis de radiación, para que las tomografías sean mucho más rápidas y así disminuir los artefactos y evitar repetir, que la repetición es lo que haría que aumentemos la dosis de radiación, y eso no es la idea en nuestros pacientes pediátricos. El octavo tips es utilice kilovoltaje fijo. Digamos que el kilovoltaje es muy importante, que lo utilicemos entre 70 y 100, ¿cierto? Según la indicación clínica para hacer la tomografía, y ojalá que esté fijo, o sea, no lo dejemos modulado en los equipos, para que este parámetro que produce tanta luz o tanta, digamos, rayos de radiación y tanta penetración, siempre sea el mismo durante todo el estudio, y solo dejemos el miliamperaje modulado para que realmente estemos haciendo una tomografía de baja dosis de radiación. El noveno tips es que la mesa del tomógrafo sea lo más rápido posible, y lo mismo la rotación del gantry, para evitar, obviamente, sobreexponer zonas de radiación, y además de esto, que el estudio sea muy rápido, sea de baja dosis, y evitemos la repetición. Es muy importante el movimiento de la mesa, es lo que nosotros llamamos el pitch. El tip número 10, nunca hacer una tomografía sin una indicación clínica específica. Creo que esto es muy importante, que esté bien justificado, y ahí es nuestra labor como residentes de radiología, como radiólogos pediátricos, como tecnólogos, físicos, médicos, o sea, todo un departamento de radiología, y es que involucremos a los clínicos, que llamemos al pediatra, que llamemos al neumólogo, que llamemos al cirujano, y le expliquemos el por qué quizás no es el mejor examen, por qué es mejor una resonancia, mejor una ecografía, por qué no vale la pena si hace 3 días le mandó una tomografía, porque si el paciente trae un estudio de otra institución, mejor miremoslo y no lo volvamos a repetir. O sea, involucrar a los clínicos en todo este tema, porque nosotros somos los responsables de la dosis de radiación, pero ellos también, porque son las que lo, ¿cierto?, mandan la tomografía. Entonces, digamos que es una actividad compartida, es una responsabilidad que es entre dos personas, y obviamente, como ya lo sabemos, podemos generar un daño a pesar de que estamos intentando dar un bienestar a nuestros pacientes. El punto número 11, o el tip 11, es nunca utilizar protocolos de tomografía de adultos para niños. Esto suena muy, como muy lógico, pero realmente, ¿por qué lo pusimos? Porque en muchos hospitales que no son pediátricos, sino hospitales generales, como lo que más se hace son pacientes adultos, llega el niño al tomógrafo y simplemente se activa en el tomógrafo el protocolo de adultos automáticamente, porque estamos con mucho trabajo con muchos pacientes y a veces no nos tomamos el tiempo de que debemos ir a la casilla de niños y tomar el protocolo de niños. Entonces es volver a crear conciencia y decir, por favor, hagamos una pausa cuando tengamos un paciente pediátrico y realmente seleccionemos el protocolo de paciente pediátrico que está indicado en nuestro niño. Y el último tips, que es muy importante, es controlar la dosis de radiación con niveles de referencia de dosis locales, regionales o internacionales. La idea es que todavía no tenemos unos niveles de dosis de radiación en Latinoamérica, que es en lo cual estamos trabajando en este momento. Nos estamos comparando con Europa, con Estados Unidos, o quizás hay algunos niveles de referencia de algunos hospitales locales a nivel de Latinoamérica. Entonces, tratémonos de comparar mientras sacamos realmente nuestros niveles, y la idea es que siempre estemos todos muy similares, porque no hay nada escrito, no hay el nivel de referencia ideal para decir siempre debemos hacer las tomografías así, siempre debemos tener esta dosis efectiva o siempre debemos tener este DLP o este CT de volumen. No lo hay, pero la idea es tratar de que estemos todos muy similares con unas dosis lo más baja posible, pero con buena calidad diagnóstica. Toda esta campaña, todos estos tips que ustedes acaban de ver, pues hicimos una conferencia con un tecnólogo médico en el mes de octubre del 2023, en la cual está en nuestro canal de YouTube, y allá se pueden acercar los que estén interesados en este tema. En el canal de YouTube de la Sociedad Latinoamericana de Radiología, pues tenemos todos nuestros tips, los 12 explicados un poco más detalladamente, para que cada uno pueda conocer del tema de radiación. La verdad es un tema que para mí es muy apasionante, es fácil, no es tan complicado, y de una forma muy didáctica pueden entender como más a profundidad cada tips y pueden ver la conferencia y la clase, que es importante. ¿Cómo medimos nuestra campaña? Porque es importante siempre que lancemos algo, medirnos, y vimos nuestras redes sociales. Estos son nuestros seguidores que tenemos en Facebook, casi 1.900, en Instagram 2.000, y realmente aumentamos nuestros seguidores en relación con la campaña. Tuvimos más o menos alrededor de 32.000 visitas en todas nuestras redes sociales y descargas de las historias y de todo el tema en relación con la campaña. Así que esto es muy exitoso. Sirvió todo esto porque la lanzamos en conjunto con todas las sociedades de radiología a nivel de Latinoamérica. Y, por ejemplo, en Instagram vimos que tuvimos un impacto. Generalmente pues tenemos estos seguidores, pero vieron todo el tema de las campañas, casi 5.000 personas, así que eso es importante llegar y tratar de concientizar con esto. A nivel del canal de YouTube, tuvimos al menos 444 visitas, se nos adicionaron 34 seguidores, que es importante. Sigue ahí nuestro canal para los que lo quieran utilizar. Y a nivel de Colombia, pudimos medir como cada tips, cómo se comportó, y digamos que en Facebook tuvimos casi alrededor de 2.000 visitas, en Instagram también entre 2.000 y 2.500 visitas de cada tips, cada uno pues con una variabilidad, pero es importante saber que tuvo un impacto y que la gente lo vio, y en X aproximadamente entre 800 y 900. Así que con esta campaña irradiemos conciencia con estas cosas tan sencillas y tan básicas, que no solo se aplican a pediatría, esto lo podemos también aplicar para adultos, y creo que lo deberíamos hacer porque es importante, y es que tengamos como conciencia, que motivemos, que eduquemos a todo el mundo, nos eduquemos nosotros mismos, a nuestros estudiantes, tecnólogos, a todos nuestros clínicos alrededor, que continuemos con este tema porque es importante, es nuestro trabajo, es nuestra pasión. No hay que tenerle miedo a la radiación, pero hay que ser conscientes de lo que puede producir y de todo lo que podemos hacer con ella, y realmente medirnos, que es lo importante, el paso a seguir en la actualidad con esta campaña, y es mirar si esto hace un impacto positivo y volver a medirnos. Ya tenemos más o menos unas dosis de base de cómo estamos y de cómo seguimos hacia el futuro, y tratar de mejorar, obviamente, por todos nuestros niños en Latinoamérica. Así que espero que les haya gustado esta pequeña introducción a este concurso de casos, que es súper emocionante, y que obviamente creo que toda Latinoamérica agradecemos al Hospital de Niños de Filadelfia y a todo su equipo de educación por apoyarnos y estar con todas estas iniciativas. Muchas gracias.
Grande, Lina. Gracias. A ver, ok. Sí, muchísimas gracias por esa presentación. Me encanta esa campaña. And obviously, the first question that we have for you here is an easy one. It's like, can we get the tips in English? And I think they are available, right?
Perfecto.
So, aside from, like, so we will be sharing that, and obviously we want others to join, so we can take this campaign as a starting point and sharing it with all of our partners in other countries and other regions of the world. So we thank Lina for that excellent presentation, and we are gonna move to the cases. That is, it's a busy agenda today, but and I think that you will enjoy all the cases. Mohammed, you tell me. Oh, Monica is introducing. So I'm gonna mute here.
Hey, good morning, everyone. We are ready to start our case competition. Everyone pay attention. We will start with a case from Brazil. From Hospital Israelita Albert Einstein, we have Dr. Victor Romano, will present unusual presentation of mesenteric cyst.
Good afternoon. I am Victor Romano, a third-year radiology resident in Albert Einstein Hospital from São Paulo, Brazil. Oriented by Dr. Simeshim and Dr. Oranges, I will bring in this brief minutes a case of unusual presentation of mesenteric cyst. I have no conflict of interest. This is a case of a four-year-old boy who arrived in the emergency department complaining of severe abdominal pain accompanied by fever for one day. Upon examination, he exhibited a distended abdomen and generalized tenderness of palpation. Of past history, this patient has gastroesophageal reflux. Initial ultrasound revealed the presence of free ascites, setting the stage for comprehensive diagnostic evaluation. So in this ultrasound reconstruction, we can see free fluid inside the peritoneum. Note that it spanned the pathogen-phragmatic space. Despite extensive testing, including imaging studies and laboratory analysis, no definitive cause for his symptoms were identified. Notably, a percentage review exuded fluid devoid of microbial or neoplastic elements, while routine blood tests returned remarkable results. Navigating through negative findings, the clinical team grappled with the enigma of patient's conditions. With ascites and spontaneous bacterial peritonitis emerging as the leading presumptive diagnosis, a decision was made to initiate home antibiotics therapy while scheduling follow-up ultrasound assessment. Approximately 2 months later, a subsequent ultrasound revealed a new fluid collection with punctured hyperechoic foci floating within the effusion. There is a conglomerate bowel loops distributed in the center of the abdomen. We also can see that this fluid had thin internal septation and spared the pathodiaphragmatic and splenodiaphragmatic spaces. Further imaging investigation via CT and MRI scans reveal a large collection of intraperitoneal fluid extended from the labor margin into the pelvis with clustered bowel loops floating in the center. And as suspected in the ultrasound, this fluid did not exhibit typical ascites imaging characteristics. Basically, it was not distributed around the labor and the spleen. Here is the MRI image, where we can see better the thin septa within the fluid collection and the clustered bowel loops in the center. The diagnosis of episodicity was made and culminating in the exploratory laboratory. Within the abdomen cavity, a sac-like cyst structure tethered to a thin ornamental layer was found, revealing the pathological diagnosis of mesenteric inclusion cyst with chronic inflammation. With the mystery solved, our patient underwent successful with surgical intervention and experienced an uneventful recovery. For take-home message, I want you to know that episodicity is defined as an abdominal distension mimicking ascites. When PAE is caused by large abdominal cyst, it is difficult to distinguish from simple ascites because of the presence of an ultra-thin wall and large liquid collection. Many cases of pseudocytes suffer diagnostic and therapeutic delay, and some are only diagnosed during surgical exploration. This case description should increase the awareness of clinicians for that condition. It also suggests that the absence of liquid between the liver and the diaphragm is a specific, although not pathognomonic, element at imaging that may help to differentiate pseudocytes from free ascites. Thank you for your attention.
Great case. Now we're going to proceed with a case from Argentina. We have Dr. Marisa Zimmerman presenting from Victor Villela Children's Hospital Rosario. The case is cerebral cavernous malformation and continuous venous malformation.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Dr. Marisa Zimmerman. I'm a pediatric dermatologist at the Villela Children's Hospital in Rosario, Santa Fe, Argentina. Our case report is about a 2-year-old female infant who was born full-term with a prenatal ultrasound that showed cerebral mass. The sagittal brain MRI revealed venous malformations in the right frontal region. Physical examination demonstrated 2 small blue purple color cutaneous nodules in the hands and feet that corresponded to venous malformation by biopsy that showed thin wall vessels without intervening normal cutaneous component. We propose it could be a case of blue rubber blood nevus or cerebral cavernous and cutaneous malformation syndromes. In the first month of life, she has a stroke and seizures treated with antiepileptic. Sagittal tomography shows hematoma in the right frontal region. After 3 months, onset of left upper extremity weakness and additional seizures, a repeat MRI was performed. It showed enlargement of the lesions and multiple lobules suggested of cavernous malformation adjacent to venous anomaly. In the coronal view of the MRI, you can see polymicrocelia. This finding was the key to the diagnosis of a sporadic cavernous malformation with developmental venous anomaly, and sirolimus was started. The axial gridding echo MRI also revealed developmental venous anomaly adjacent to multiple lobules showing cavernomas. She pulled favorably. Catheter angiography confirmed the vascular anomaly described at MRI due to decreasing size. And it demonstrates a venous anomaly without adjacent malformation consistent with cavernoma. In this algorithm, you could appreciate it, that a sporadic CCM's histological phenotype is different from blue rubber blood nevus and CCM's familiar that could have other cutaneous components like muscle and hyperkeratosis respectively. And this could explain different cutaneous phenotypes. Analyzing imaging phenotype, we found that CCMs sporadic more frequently appear like a single lesion with developmental venous anomaly, like you can see in the slide. And this association is a greatest risk factor for cerebral hemorrhage. Revising the literature, we found a genetic correlation between familial multiple CCMs type 4 Sambrowski classification and germline mutations, and sporadic CCMs mosaic type 2 and 3 Sambrowski classification and MAP Fricke-3 mutation. Even more, Wendt et al. Report this mutation detected in over 95% of the porcine-like CCMs that are detectable under radiological evaluation. And somatic activating PIK3CA were detected simultaneously. Polymicrogyria also could be affected in this pathway. For this reason, and because the lesion was growing, we decided to start with sirolimus. In conclusion, the clinical, histological, and imaging phenotype-genotype correlation was mandatory to choose the best therapy for this life-threatening case. Thank you very much.
Coming up, we have a case from Mexico. We have Dr. Alma Sánchez Baza from Hospital Infantil de México, Federico Gómez, presenting ovarian neuroendocrine tumor in pediatrics.
Hello, my name is Alma Sánchez Baza. I'm going to talk about ovarian neuroendocrine tumor in pediatrics. We're going to start with our clinical story. We have a 12-year-old female with negative family background and chickenpox at 5 years old. She starts suffering 8 days before the internment with abdominal pain in LDC, getting better in left lateral decubitus. No automedication or medical assessment. Then, early society is at and the presence of a mass palpable in left side. We also have the USG heterogene mass with vascular captation at Doppler color. Labs tumoral markers AFP 1.13, CA 125,631, and beta HCG less than 2.3. In this slide, we can see the report of a pre-surgical abdominal tomography. The tumor apparently depends on left annex of 1702 cc volume. In addition, a 5 millimeters left anterobasal pulmonary nodule plus mesenteric lymph nodes and bilateral pleural effusion was evident. In this slide, we can see the same as in the previous one, but this one is a coronal section. In this slide, we have the tomography after surgery. A simple and contrast enhanced abdominal tomography is performed, showing increase in secondary deposits mainly in the liver, mesentery, and abundant free peritoneal fluid. Reside 1.1 as disease progression. Here we have a coronal view from the slide before. In hospital evolution, local control oncological surgery, left salpingo oophorectomy, ovarian routine and partial omentectomy. We find peritoneal fluid with hematic stain, solid tumor with a smooth surface measuring 25 times 20 centimeters, peritoneal implants in the liver, greater omentum diaphragmatic dome, iliac fossae, posterior surface of the uterus and pelvic cavity. Malignant neuroendocrine tumor compatible with primary anaplastic carcinoid tumor. Chemotherapy sessions began currently with an adequate prognosis. Discussion. Primary neuroendocrine tumors of the ovary are rare and consist of a group of heterogeneous neoplasm that express similar immunohistochemical markers. Primary carcinoid tumors of the ovary are rare entities that represent approximately 0.3% of all carcinoid tumors and less than 0.1% of all ovarian neoplasms, with a good prognosis and generally limited to the ovarian parenchyma. However, early diagnosis is very important to improve the patient's prognosis.
It was a great case. Now we're going to move to a case from Peru, from Instituto Nacional de Salud del Niño San Borja. We have Sandra Orbegoso presenting multisystemic tuberculosis radiological findings.
Good morning to everyone. My name is Sandra Orbegoso, and I am radiology resident from Instituto Nacional de Salud del Niño de San Borja. We present this case denominated multisystemic tuberculosis radiological finding associated to immunodepression due to interferon gamma receptor 1 deficit.
No disclosures.
A 3-year-old boy from the Peruvian jungle region with no relevant perinatal medical history. Approximately 40 months ago, his mother noted progressive right orbital edema. Not any family history of rare disease such as leukemia, rheumatological disease, or early death. Our patient underwent a magnetic resonance at the local hospital, which found a solid mass with the right orbit. So the shale present with proptosis and inflammatory change around the right orbit, malnutrition, and cervical lymphadenopathies. The laboratory test revealed leukocytosis, neutrophilia, and increased PCR. During hospitalization, view radiograph of the skull and the chest shows multiple extensive osteoregulation in the bowel and 5th and 6th costal arch level. And the same, the femur shows an osteoregulation with slightly scleroded edge and the right proximal femur. Brain CT coronal reconstruction in soft part window and bone window reveal extensive erosion from multiple coalescent punch-out lesions at the skull. Magnetic resonance shows extensive bone involvement on the sphenoid and frontal bone with right frontal mass present avid marked contract enchasement. During the hospitalization, the patient allowed for Langerhans cell histiocytosis and Gorham disease. Lesion cultures were positive to tuberculosis, and immunologists suggest to discard immunodeficiency. The extension of multisystemic affectation raised the suspicion of primary immunodeficiency. After weeks to discard of the most common cause of immunodeficiency, results showed mutation autosomic on the gene that codifies the interferon gamma receptor type 1. So, primary immunodeficiency confirmed great susceptibility to infection. Severe ENF-associated deficiencies are associated with death in the absence of the transplantation. There are few published cases of about the association between tuberculosis and primary immunodeficiency. Take-home messages. Tuberculosis continues to be a very prevalent pathology in Latin America, being the great imitator of the wide variety of pathologies. In multifocal lesion, there are other differential diagnoses other than histiocytosis, Gorham disease, etc. Primary immunodeficiency are rare, but they are a group of pathologies that we have to take into account. We present this case to also encourage to do more research on this association because there is not sufficient data. It's important to have genetic sequencing in patients with suspected primary immunodeficiency. Thank you.
Here we have had 4 great cases. We're going to proceed with the 5th case. This is another infectious disease. We have Dr. Ramon David Perez Rojas from Argentina, from Centro de Diagnóstico Rossi, who will present dengue, a case of diffuse alveolar hemorrhage.
My name is Ramon David Perez. I am a second year resident doctor in radiology of the Rossi Center in Buenos Aires, Argentina. Our clinical case is about diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. A 74-year-old woman came to the emergency room with a 48-hour history of fever, arthralgia, asthenia, bradycychia, androsinus, medical history. She's a smoker for 20 plus years with multiple comorbidities. complete vaccination for her age, previous operation, appendectomy, cholecystectomy, gastric sleeve, social origin, middle class, she lives in Buenos Aires, physical examination, stable vital signs, bradypsy, upon auscultation, Crakeless, we observed in both hematologies, predominantly in the lung-based laboratory, hemoglobin 10 grains per deciliter, hematocrit 30%, with blood cells 1800, platelets 59,000. Dengue virus antigen detection positive and negative for influenza and COVID. Obviously, the diagnosis of dengue was made. In this slide, the image shows the lung parenchyma window axial section with diffuse bilateral perihilar opacities with ground glass opacities associated with thickening of the interlobular septa. This is the crazy paving pattern. On admission, 48 hours after the onset of symptoms, the chest tomography scan was requested, which was acquired using 128 channel field tomography. The mediastinal window show a small pleural effusion predominantly on the right side and an increased density of the interventricular septum. This is the septal sign seen in patients with anemia, asking the patient, our patient. In this slide of the 70 day of illness, a controlled chest CT scan was performed showing greater lung parenchymal involvement with diffuse station of plexiglass glass opacities, crazy paving, IR bronchogram, and areas of consolidation. In this slide, consolidation opacities with vessel predominance. This is not observed in the previously studied. In this slide, the coronal window shows the rapid progression on the aforementioned infiltrators with greater station of the areas of consolidation, diagnosing diffuse alveolar hemorrhaging. Evolution. On admission after the first CT scan, an associated respiratory infection was suspected. Treatment was started with antibiotics, bronchodilators, and corticosteroids. On the seventh day of illness, the patient present with respiratory failure requiring orotracheal intubation, mechanical ventilation, hemoptysis, and a drop in platelet count 40,000, so a controlled CT scan was requested, which showed a progression of the aforementioned infiltrators with the greater station of the areas of consolidation and a diagnosis of diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. On the ninth day of illness, she presents with multiple organ failure associated with respiratory distress syndrome. RDS was treated with vasopressin without response and finally present with extreme bradycardia, has systolia with CPR without retors, has spontaneous circulation, and death. Discussion. Maybe this case is important to consider diffuse alveolar hemorrhage as one of the forces of evolution of severe dengue fever, especially in patients with progression of pulmonary infiltrators in the context of the plateletopenia, though the definitive diagnosis is made by fibrobronchoscopy with bronchohalberd lavage to determine the presence of the red blood cells in the sample. It is often not possible to perform this invasive study due to the hemodynamic instability of the patient, so it is important to have a high index of suspicion in imaging studies. One of the relevant data is the fall in hemoglobin without obvious bleeding, bearing in mind that most patients will not present with hemoptysis, which is related to the radiological findings in which there is basically ground glass with a tendency to consolidation associated with thickening of the septa, adopting the crazy paving pattern. Reference. Thank you for all.
Now we're going to move to another case from Mexico. We have Dr. Leonor Lopez Hernandez, who will present from Children's Hospital of Mexico, Federico Gomez. The case is giant Kaposiform hemangioendothelioma.
Greetings. Today we are going to talk about a report of a case of a giant caposiform hemangioendothelioma in pediatrics. We are residents in the Department of Pediatric Imaging at the Children's Hospital of Mexico, Federico Gomez, in Mexico City. Our mentor's name is the physician Dulce Judith Almanza Aranda. And we are going to talk about a one-day-old male patient who presented multiple hyperpigmented nevi throughout the body, in the face, neck, thorax, and extremities. And although this kid had many anatomical regions involved, the right extremity was the only one with an increase of volume, while the left lower extremity was anatomically intact. The first suspected diagnosis was an arteriovenous malformation, which was described as soft, not indurated, with a region of violet color at its distal end. It measured approximately 8 by 7 centimeters. And even though this patient had previous imaging studies, the magnetic resonance was the one that better helped us to characterize the injury. So here we have a T1-weighted magnetic resonance in a coronal view, showing the right pelvic limb with an increase of volume dependent of soft tissues, which is found surrounding right femur, tibia, and fibula. After the administration of paramagnetic contrast medium shows a general encasement of the previous commented tissues, and in the angioresonance shows the irrigation of the right pelvic limb dependent on the external iliac artery and the femoral artery as well, that give multiple collateral branches in their course. And finally, here we have the 3D reconstruction showing the irrigation of the right pelvic limb with its branches and the associated increase in volume and some calcifications located in the same region. So for the discussion, we have that caposiform hemangioendothelioma is an aggressive and is usually associated with systemic morbidity, such as disseminated intravascular coagulopathy, also known as Casabac-Meritz syndrome. Also newer therapies such as sirolimus, which is a mammalian target of rapamycin, have shown significant success. Embolization has been used with varying success in the setting of prominent feeding vessels, while complete surgical excision is a curative measure. Also, limb amputation has rarely but successfully been used in the setting of an isolated extremity lesion that cannot be medically controlled in a critical ill patient. In the case of this little kid, he presents a deformity in the right lower extremity, and with the images obtained from the X-ray to the magnetic resonance, where a better characterization was evident in the basic sequences. As the data on the clinical evolution, patient presents an important complication associated with hemangioendothelioma, which was the Casabac-Meritz syndrome. And this patient required surgical and curative amputation of the affected limb, as well as medical and curative management. Here we have the references, and that's all for now.
Thank you. Very interesting case. Now moving on to our next presenter, Dr. Pamela Romanque from the Clínica Alemana de Santiago, Universidad del Desarrollo de Chile. She is going to talk about hydatid disease beyond lung and liver.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Pamela Romanque. I'm from Santiago, Chile. I have nothing to disclose, and I will present the next case entitled hydatid disease beyond lung and liver. The case is a 32 years old male from southern Chile, from the Patagonia region, who recently had an ischemic stroke and was referred to cardiac MRI because echocardiography made to search for a cardiac embolic source showed a mass. He presented no respiratory or cardiac symptoms, but that time an eosinophilia was reported during the laboratory workup. In a loop in short axis and long axis, two chambers showed a mobile ovoid mass depending from the lateral wall of the left ventricle. In selected images from these same sequences, in short axis, long axis, two chambers, and four chambers, we can see the mass is deeply implicated in the left ventricle, myocardium, and some small daughter cysts are visible. No delay enhancement was observed, and function and volumes of the left ventricle were normal. This patient went to surgery, and the results show a human cystic echinococcosis or eidetic disease. This is a parasitic infection caused by larvae of echinococcus, which is still endemic in some sheep or cattle grazing regions. Domestic animals are the primary carriers of echinococcal organisms. Humans are infected as intermediary carriers following ingestion of contaminated food or water. Hydatid cysts can be located in various tissues, but they are more common in the liver and the lung. Cardiac involvement is a rare manifestation of echinococcus infection. ALBI is the most common site of infection, followed by RB and pericardium. Symptoms depend on the size and location of the cyst and may vary from chest pain, dyspnea, and palpitations to pulmonary embolism, myocardial infarction, pericardial effusion, and sudden death. Echocardiography, CT, and MRI can show the cystic nature of the mass and its relations to the cardiac chambers. On MRI, it's usually a characteristic oval lesion that is hypointense on T1 weight images and hyperintense on T2 weight images. Specific signs include calcification of the cystic wall, better assessed with CT, presence of daughter cyst, and membrane detachment. Surgical resection plus albendazole therapy is the treatment of choice, as it was in this case. So take home points. This is a parasitic disease to be suspected in endemic areas. Liver and lung are more commonly affected, and symptoms vary according to size and location of the cyst. Heart involvement is extremely rare. In this QR, you can find the main references of this case. Thank you very much.
These are all great cases. Now we have Dr. Gabriela Ponce from Fundación Escuela de Medicina Nuclear in Argentina, who will present the case of the least thought, Kogan.
Hello, my name is Gabriela Ponce. I'm from Mendoza, Argentina, and I'm a medical resident in Fuesman. We're gonna talk about the least thought, Kogan. We're gonna talk about a male patient of 58 years old who's a tobacco user. He consults because he has difficulty moving the face on the left side and abdominal pain. In the physical exam, we confirm left facial paralysis, bilateral hair loss, and abdominal pain. In the labs, we found high leukocytes, red blood cells on the limit, BSG and beta 2 microglobulins high. In all those finds, we decide to make a CT of abdominal and an MRI of the brain. In this image of the CT, we observe vesicular stone image. We see a dense tissue that surrounds the abdominal aorta, and we notice a multiple image of lymph nodes in mesentery. They were also visualized in the retroperitoneum and inguinal region. In the brain MRI, we observe a thickening of the lacrimal gland and the mucosa around the ethmoidal cell. given the findings and the high suspicion of myeloproliferate syndrome, a retroperitoneal lymph node biopsy was performed. The biopsy indicates B lymphoid population, and it says that no clonal restriction of the B lymphoid population was observed. Due to the persistence of a diagnosis doubt, it was decided to perform a PET-CT with FDG. In the PET-CT study, thickness of the lacrimal gland is observed with intense uptake of the radiopharmaceutical. At the level of the middle ear, intense accumulation of FDG is observed. The dense tissue observed around the abdominal aorta presents great FDG uptake. The same type of uptake is observed in the aortic arc. To understand the uptake of the great vessels in PET, we use measure visual scale that compares the uptake of the liver with the uptake of the great vessels. If the uptake of the wall on the great vessels exceeds the hepatic uptake, it is interpreted as an inflammation of the vessels, a vasculitis. Patient was diagnosed and treated. 9 months later, a post-treatment control was carried out. We observed that there's no uptake in the lacrimal gland or in the walls of the large vessels. The final diagnosis was Cowan syndrome. This is a chronic inflammatory disease of autoimmune etiology. Involves audiovestibular system, the eyes, and other organs. It appears between the third and the fourth decade of life without no gender predominance. The diagnosis is difficult and late because it is done by exclusion of other disease. It has two ways of presentation, typical and atypical. Both of the presentations associate vasculitis and systemic symptoms. The most common cardiovascular condition is the aortitis. Assessment was performed. Bibliography. Thank you everyone for the time. I hope that you all have a great day.
That was a great case. Sorry everyone, we have been having technical issues. So moving on to our next case, Dr. Daniel Quintero Pulgarin from Colombia, from the Fundación Hospital de la Misericordia. He's going to talk about bilateral testicular adrenal rest tumors.
Hello to everyone. My name is Daniel Quintero Pulgarin. I am a pediatric radiology fellow at Universidad Nacional and Fundación OMI in Bogotá, Colombia. My mentor is Dr. Luz Angela Moreno, pediatric radiologist. We bring the case of bilateral testicular adrenal rest tumors, a challenging diagnosis simulating neoplasm. Our patient is a 13-year-old boy from Aguasul, Casanare, Colombia, with a family history of a brother with salt-losing congenital adrenal hyperplasia. He had a medical history of a diagnosis in the first month of life of also congenital adrenal hyperplasia that was in treatment with oral steroids. 2 months before, he had an episode of acute scrotum and he was suspected to have a left testicular torsion. He was taken to a left orchiectomy in another institution with the pathology reporting a testicular seminoma that was compromising 80% of the parenchyma. At our institution, admission labs showed elevated adrenal steroidal hormones and tumor markers were negative. Ultrasound of the right testicle showed a hypoechoic lobulated mass centered in the same site of the mediastinum testis, with a lineal, more hyperechoic pattern that resembled the lobules within the testicles. The lesion was hypervascular at color Doppler and with normal low resistance arterial spectrum. We can see the rest of the parenchyma with normal echogenicity. An abdominal CT was performed and showed no signs of metastasis, but we can see the thickened bilateral adrenal glands, thicker than the diaphragm, in relation with the congenital hyperplasia. And in the right testicle, the central lesion showed avid contrast enhancement. A pelvic MRI was performed again with no signs of metastasis, but the right testicle lesion could be better characterized. And in these detailed images of the right testicle, we can see how the lesion is slightly hyperintense in T1 compared with the surrounding normal testicular parenchyma, hypointense in T2, and with avid contrast enhancement. And if we compare the lesion with the normal diffusion-restricted peripheral parenchyma, the central lesion itself has not diffusion restriction. A revision of the pathology slides of the left testicle was performed at our institution and confirmed the presence of polygonal clusters of cells with ulterior cytoplasmatic nuclear relation and an aspect very similar of that of a normal adrenal gland. In this schematic image, we can see how different degrees of severity can be seen with this tumor. In our case, the patient had the most advanced stage. So, testicular adrenal rest tumors are a common complication of male congenital adrenal hyperplasia, up to 89%, and it originates from aberrant adrenal cells in the testis. It is associated with poor hormonal control, with concomitant elevated ACTH, bilateral typical lobulated hypoechoic hypervascular mediastinal centered lesions by ultrasound can help differentiate from other malignant neoplasms, and a multidisciplinary approach, such as in our case, and teamwork can help to avoid unnecessary orchiectomy. Here are some RECT references.
These have all been great cases. We're going to move on to the 10th case. So remember that after this case, we're going to have a 5-minute break so that everyone can rest a little bit. And then after the break, we will continue to the second batch of 10 cases. For now, we have Dr. Enzo Gabriel Redolfi Mema from the Fundación Escuela Medicina Nuclear in Argentina, presenting Sagliker, a little known entity.
Hello, my name is Enzo Redolfi. I'm fourth grade radiology resident. I am studying in FUESMEN, Fundación Escuela de Medicina Nuclear. I am from Mendoza, Argentina. My tutor is Soraya Cherlo, and other team members is Facundo Manuel Reale. We are going to talk about Sagliker, that it's a little known syndrome. Well, we are going to introduce a 44 years old male patient with socioeconomic context of lower social class and living in rural areas that limits his access to health systems. The patient was admitted due to phosphocalcium metabolism alterations, and a personal history highlights 15 years of kidney failure on dialysis 3 times a week, hyperparathyroidism, maturational delay, and arterial hypertension. The lab results, the most important is parathormone of 1,200 units per liter. So, with the analytics, we decided to perform an ultrasound of the thyroid glands, where we found at least 2 round images at the bottom of the lobes that are hypoechoic and presents a lot of vascularization. And we assumed that could be related to a parathyroid hyperplasia. In order to continue with the study of the patient, we decided to perform a school X-ray where we found multiple radiolucinarias, some dotted, and we that gives the sign of salt and pepper related with hyperparathyroidism. Also, we found a calvarium thickening that means the chronicity of the illness. Next, we perform a chest X-ray where we found rectification of the costophrenic angles and two ovoid well-defined marginal radiopaque images indicated with the arrows, with the white arrows, which we interpreted as brown tumors. Also, we can see an increase in the density of the pulmonar parenchyma that is related with the compression of these tumors. Then we perform a hand X-ray in order to continue studying the patient, and we found thickening of the long bones, as you can see, and the decrease in bone mineralization, also some subchondral cyst or geodes. Then, in order to finish our control of the patient, we decided to perform a school CT where we found calcification of the left mastoid process and calvarian thickening in the axial projection. Also, multiple ovoid hyperdense images with an allo of lower density in relation of brown tumors, as you can see over here. Well, what can I say about this disease? The patient presents with secondary parathyroidism, hyperplasia, and balancing calcium metabolism proved to be challenging. So, consequently, surgical resection of the parathyroid glands was decided upon. This was decided by the nephrology area. Then, with the chest and skull X-rays, we arrived to the diagnosis of sac-like. In order to talk a little about the patient, following the surgical resection of the parathyroid glands, calcium metabolism was regulated, resulting in the decrease of phosphorus levels. What can I say about sac-like? It's characterized by the coexistence of chronic kidney failure and bone, predominantly fascial changes, along with the consequence metabolism impaired. The disease initiates with chronic kidney failure, resulting in the decrease in vitamin D and serum calcium levels. As calcium levels decrease, the parathyroid counter-regulatory system is activated, leading to an increase in parathormone. Phosphorus attempts to be removed while calcium starts to be retained by the kidneys. And as we know, kidneys are failing, so both in an ineffective manner. This results in increasing bone resorption. In response, osteopenic bone defends itself by increasing bone reproduction, resulting in the formation of brown tumors. In all the studies, we found that three genes are involved in this condition.
Okay, we're ready to have a 5-minute break, so we will see you in 5 minutes.
Hello everyone, we're back. So we're moving to our next presenter, Dr. Carla Annabel Borgna. She's from Argentina, Hospital Universitario Austral. She's going to talk about synchronous tumors with embryological diagnosis.
Good morning, my name is Carla Borgna. I'm a career resident in Hospital Austral, Argentina, and I will be speaking about two synchronous tumors in an assisted reproductive technology newborn, a case report. Authors don't have any disclosure, and the clinical information of this case, it was a newborn with a right facial cervicolateral tumor with a history of ICSI, and lab findings that shows an elevated level of alpha-fetoprotein. Here we have the fetal MRI that reveals solid tumors in the maxillary region. And then after birth, MRI was performed. Here we have a coronal T2 weighted image, and we can see a polylobulated solid mass with septals in the parotid space, and also a heterogeneous lesion in the liver. Here we have the actual diffusion weighted image, which shows diffusion restriction. And in 2-1 weighted image, the lesion shows an isointense signal with hyperintense dots suggesting microbleed. Here we have actual contrast enhanced T1 image showing a heterogeneous enhancement. And in the tomography, the lesion was localized in the caudate segment. And also a satellite lesion was found in the eighth segment. So when it comes to head and neck tumors, three main differential diagnoses should be considered: neuroblastoma, teratoma, and sialoblastoma. Neuroblastoma and teratoma were ruled out because of the lack of calcifications and bone involvement, which leaves sialoblastoma to be the most likely. Regarding to liver tumors, hepatoblastoma should be the first diagnosis to be considered in this age group. Here we have the histopathological findings of the tumor and the take-home point, synchronous association of sialoblastoma and hepatoblastoma is extremely rare. Parotid gland and liver have a common embryonal origin, and the abnormality would affect the cells of both organs. And hepatoblastoma is the most common malignant tumor of the liver in childhood. And hepatoblastoma and sialoblastoma are among the embryological tumors associated with elevated alpha fetal protein. Child conceived by attending reproductive technology were also at increased risk for solid tumor. Here are the references. Thank you very much. Good morning.
We started with the second batch of cases. Coming up, we are having a case from Brazil, Dr. Amanda Tavares from Children's Institute Hospital da Clínica de Universidad de São Paulo, presenting perivascular epithelial cell tumor.
Hello, I'm Amanda Tavares, and the case is perivascular epithelioid cell tumor, PEComa, in the proliferative phase with possible progression to pediatric type angiosarcoma from Instituto da Criança do Hospital das Clínicas, São Paulo, Brazil, and I have no conflict of interest with this presentation. A 9-year-old male patient, previously healthy, presented with asthenia, weight loss, and a significant increase in abdominal volume 2 months before admission. He sought an external cervix where a contrast-enhanced CT was performed, which showed hepatomegaly at the expense of a liver mass suggestive of high-flow arteriovenous malformation. He was hospitalized and presented some episodes of hematochezia and vomiting without blood, triggering secondary anemia and requiring a blood transfusion. The patient was referred to our service for continued care and with the aim of further diagnostic elucidation. To prevent him from being radiated again, as he already undergone CT at the external cervix, we continued the investigation with abdominal MRI that showed a massive liver lesion occupying almost the entire right lobe with anomalous caliber and mishapened internal vessels, in addition to hemorrhagic saccular areas involving these vessels, some with signs of recent bleeding. Here, we can see early contrast of the large vessel in the arterial phase that persists in the venous phase, which was curious. And there was no obvious extratumoral artery feeding this large vessel. The lesion measured approximately 17 centimeters and there was a slight compression on the bile duct of hepatic segment 7 and 8, promoting minimal upstream ectasia. The lesion also displaced the gallbladder, pancreas, and superior mesenteric vessels to the left. And based on these findings, it was suspected that it was not an arteriovenous malformation, but a primary neoplastic lesion, especially of mesenchymal origin or vascular origin, such as angiosarcomas. The ultrasound showed that the large vessels seen on the MRI had a typically venous flow, and a segment with a lot of aliasing and turbulent flow was identified, possibly representing low resistance flow close to the large vessel. And we suspected that there could be a fistula in there. So we performed a contrast enhanced ultrasound. And the contrast enhanced ultrasound showed a fistula between the hepatic artery and the large vessel, which served to guide the surgical team towards a less bloody and safer approach. Given the findings and delicate prognosis, it was decided to perform upfront surgery, and a right hepatectomy was performed. And upon clamping the large vessel suggestive of fistula, the tumor shriveled. This turned out to be an unusual case of sarcoma, and the proliferative phase was possible progression to pediatric type angiosarcoma. And this is an extremely rare neoplasm, more common in female, and the clinical presentation is unspecific as well as radiological features. It usually behaves in benign fashion, although local recurrence and even malignant behavior are encountered, mimicking malignant sarcomas. Surgical excision is usually curative, and the prognosis is uncertain. To take home message, on CT MRI and ultrasound images, most hepatic sarcomas are well-defined, heterogeneous, and arterio-enhanced masses with dysmorphic vessels with or without fat. With the potential to be malignant, timely surgical resection and long-term follow-up may be helpful for improving the prognosis. Axial methods are important for characterization, staging, and surgical planning, but contrast-enhanced ultrasound can help guide the surgical team towards a less bloody and safer approach. Here are my reference. Thanks for your attention. Hello.
Wow, amazing. So moving on to our next case from Mexico. Dr. Diego Mendoza Vanegas from the Universidad Autónoma de Nuevo León. He's going to talk about indirect spontaneous carotid cavernous fistula.
Good afternoon. My name is Diego Jose Mendoza Vanegas, and today I will be sharing this interesting case. It's named Navigating Complexity, Hemophilia and Anatomical Variants in Indirect Spontaneous Carotid Cavernous Fistula Management. I have no financial disclosures or a conflict of interest with the material. So the case description is the following. He is a 15-year-old male patient who initially presented with left eye ecchymosis in June of last year, which progressively worsened to proptosis by October of the same year. Ophthalmologic examination revealed an elevated intraocular pressure, and they determined to perform an angio MRI. He has an past medical history that includes type A hemophilia. And these are the imaging findings. This is an actual T1 weighted image that demonstrates proptosis of the left ocular globe pointed by the yellow arrow. This is a contrast enhanced T1 weighted image in actual that illustrates or shows asymmetry of the cavernous sinuses, the left one being somewhat larger than the right one. We also saw a dilation of the left superior ophthalmic vein. This is an image of maximum intensity projection time of flight, MR angiography, that revealed an aberrant origin of the left ophthalmic artery, shown in the yellow arrowhead. This is an anatomical variation. This vessel shares its origin with one of the meningeal branches, shown in the with the blue arrow. And this meningeal branch shunts, or has a shunt between the meningeal branch and the cavernous sinus, and consequently dilates and enlarges the left superior ophthalmic vein. Digital subtraction angiography confirmed the MRI findings. So here we see left ophthalmic artery aberrant origin, highlighted in yellow. Okay, this anomaly shares its origin with the meningeal branch, pointed by the blue arrow. And we also saw the shunt, highlighted in red, that communicates the meningeal branch and the cavernous sinus, enlarging the superior ophthalmic vein, shown here. So the diagnosis was the following: spontaneous indirect carotid cavernous fistula barrel type B. The course of this disease and the treatment was the following. He underwent meticulous preparation for his procedures. He received factor 8 1 hour before the procedure and additional doses afterwards because of his diagnosis. He had hemophilia type A. And a diagnostic and therapeutic angiography was performed. They tried to embolize the vascular anomaly, but they were not successful. Following this, a trigeminal surgery was performed the following month, resulting in the successful treatment of the fistula. The main takeaway points are the following. Early recognitions of this type of diseases are crucial, especially in these patients, in order to avoid the consequences that are vision loss or intracranial hemorrhage. Treatments should be personalized, considering the age, the underlying conditions, and the anatomical variations, in order to have the success, in order to have success of the procedures. Also, a multidisciplinary approach is essential for the comprehensive care. These are my references. Thank you very much.
These are all great cases. Just one reminder is that we have one prize that it's called the People's Choice Awards, where we will post a poll at the end of the cases, and each one of the attendees of this webinar will be able to vote for their favorite case. So just keep that in mind and stay tuned. Coming up, we have Dr. Carlos Almeida from Ecuador, from Hospital Metropolitano in Ecuador, with the case identifying common radiological signs of dengue.
Hello, everyone. My name is Carlos Almeida. I'm a third year radiology resident from Ecuador. I prepared this case with Dr. Pedro Daza, who's also a third year resident, and our mentor was Dr. Santiago Vallejo. The title of this case is Right Upper Quadrant Pain, Hepatomegaly and Pleural Effusion, Identifying Common Radiological Signs of Dengue. We have no disclosures, and this case is about two siblings, a boy of 7 years old and a girl of 6 years old, that came to the ER with abdominal pain in the right upper quadrant and respiratory distress. As an important fact, they had a recent travel to the Ecuadorian coast. So in the physical examination, the boy presented with desaturation, bradycardia, hepatomegaly, and a positive Murphy sign. The girl also had desaturation, hepatomegaly, and positive Murphy sign, but she also had decreased sounds at the right lung base. At the laboratory, both of them had low platelet count, as you can see here. So with this clinical and with exams, doctors at the ER decided to ask for imaging. So they asked for a chest x-ray and also for an abdominal ultrasound in both of the patients. Here we can see the boy's chest x-ray, where there's a slight obliteration of the right costal phrenic angle consistent with pleural effusion at this level. In the abdominal ultrasound, we can see that there was hepatosplenomegaly here, also gallbladder wall thickening, as you can see here. The pleural effusion in the right side was confirmed with the ultrasound, and there was also free fluid in the abdomen. The girl came a little more complicated. She had bilateral pleural effusion, as you can see, the obliteration of the costal phrenic angles here. And in the abdominal ultrasound, hepatosplenomegaly was present to also gallbladder wall thickening, as you can see here. The bilateral pleural effusion was confirmed, and also free fluid in the abdomen was seen. With these results from the imaging department, the suspicion for a tropical disease was raised, and we told the ER doctors to investigate for dengue. So the course of the disease was the next. Both were admitted to the ER. They had the x-ray, ultrasound, and labs. So the doctors decided to perform an NS1 test that came positive, and both of the patients received supportive management. The boy was discharged 3 days after without any complication, but after 3 days, the girl presented with clinical worsening, so the pediatricians decided to perform new exams, where they found hypoalbuminemia and also a parvovirus B19 co-infection. With these results and the clinical worsening, they asked for a new abdominal CT, and we performed a low dose one. And I'm going to show you the results of this exam afterwards. But the girl was discharged after 7 days without any further complications. In the abdominal CT, we can see that the gallbladder wall was thickened, as you can see here, and there was edema around it. Also, there was a periportal edema, and you can see that the pleural effusion after 5 days was gone. All of these are radiological signs of dengue, and I want to give you some key points to take home. WHO says that more than half of the world's population is at risk for dengue infection. This is because of the spread of the mosquito that is called Aedes aegypti. The vascular leakage is a key component of the pathophysiology of severe dengue and is detectable by ultrasound. And this is why we should perform ultrasound in all the patients with dengue. Also, a common ultrasound findings are gallbladder wall thickening, hepatosplenomegaly, right-sided or bilateral pleural effusion, and ascites, as it was shown in our patients. And also, I want to tell you that chest x-rays can aid in the detection for pleural fluid, but the chest ultrasound is much better because it can detect as little as 5 to 10 milliliters of pleural fluid with 100% of sensitivity. This was the case. Thank you very much for your attention. These are my references, and I hope you have a good day.
Thank you. Great case. So moving on to our next case from Chile, Dr. Luis Cie from the Pontificia Universidad Católica de Chile. He's going to talk about ectopic pancreas, an unusual cause of abdominal pain.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Luis Cie, fellow of pediatric radiology at the Pontificia Universidad Católica de Chile. And with the support of Dr. Cristian Garcia, Dr. Florencia de Barbieri, and Dr. Paulina Esparza, I will present the case of an ectopic pancreas as an unusual cause of abdominal pain. This is a case of a six-year-old boy, previously healthy, who attended the emergency department due to intense colic abdominal pain from 1 week of evolution. He had no history of fever, diarrhea, or vomiting. And between the colic episodes, the boy was otherwise asymptomatic. And considering the above, he had a routine blood test analysis and an abdominal ultrasound, both unremarkable. And during a time, a couple of intense pain episodes were witnessed by the medical staff, and a computed tomography scan was requested. In this slide, you can see a selected axial image of a computed tomography of abdomen that show a small focal area of hypervascular enhancement which is shown here in the white arrows, is in the collapsed small bowel on the left, likely jejunum. No other findings were reported. The next image is a coronal reconstruction of the same study, showing the focal area of hypervascular enhancement in the white arrows here. And to continue the study, an MR enterography was carried out. Here you can see a selected coronal image of the MR enterography, T1 weighted fat sat, showing an hyperintense focal lesion with well-defined myogenes, which are depicted here in the white arrows, related to the wall of a left small bowel loop. And it was correlating with the hypervascular area seen previously on the computed tomography. And the blue arrow, which is up here, shows a part of the body of the pancreas, which is hyperintense 2-in-T1 weighted image. In the T2 weighted image, coronal, the nodule is hypointense as depicted here, and no hyperintense areas regarding inflammation were seen. And after the gadolinium infusion, it showed habit homogeneous enhancement as shown in this image by the white arrows here. And that remains in the late portovenous phase as depicted here. And no dilated bowel loops or signs of intussusception were seen. So regarding the treatment, an elective laparoscopy exploration was carried out and localized an intramural jejunum nodule without mucosal involvement. The histology showed ectopic pancreas tissue in the jejunum wall. Here in the right, you can see a real picture of the nodule excised during the exploratory laparoscopy. And after the surgery, the boy remains asymptomatic without new abdominal pain episodes. It is important to remind that the ectopic pancreas is a rare cause of abdominal pain, mainly reported in adult patients and just a few literature reports in children. It is most commonly found in the stomach and duodenum, and to a lesser extent on the small bowel. And in terms of symptoms, it can be asymptomatic or can produce signs related to mechanical obstruction and bleeding mainly. The imaging studies are non-specific, and if located in a small bowel, it can be necessary to do an MR enterography to be able to see it. A clue that might help is that the nodule can have the same signal or enhancing pattern as the pancreas in the different phases. Excision is the recommended treatment. Thank you very much for your attention.
These are all great tips. Coming up from Hospital Escuela Universitario in Honduras, we have Dr. Denise Alejandra Salgado Guevara presenting Budd-Chiari syndrome in pediatric patients.
Hi, my name is Dr. Denise Salgado. I am a fourth year resident of Honduras Radiology Residency Program, and today I will be presenting about Budd-Chiari syndrome in a pediatric patient. I worked along with Dr. Ricardo Rivera, third year resident of the same program, as well as our mentor, Dr. Carlos Rivera, a medical radiologist, subspecialist in interventional radiology. We have no conflict of interest. And this is a case of a six-year-old girl with history of hepatic cirrhosis, child poop B, and severe anemic syndrome. She was admitted to the ER for diarrhea, globose abdomen, hepatomegaly, and collateral circulation, as shown right here on this picture. A liver biopsy was performed, which reported sinusoidal congestion. The abdominal ultrasound showed hepatomegaly with heterogeneous echostructure in the liver, as well as middle hepatic venous stenosis with reflux as shown right here in this Doppler and spectral ultrasound. The patient also had signs of portal hypertension, such as splenomegaly, ascites, and pleural effusion. The abdominal CT with IV contrast administration was performed, which showed hepatomegaly with caudate lobe hypertrophy with a caudate right lobe ratio of 0.66. It also showed these heterogeneous parenchymal enhancement in both arterial and venous phase that corresponds to congestion, as well as the splenomegaly collateral circulation and ascites previously mentioned. In the venous phase of the study, we could also see the hepatic, middle hepatic vein stenosis with a reduction of approximately 50% of its lumen near the junction with the inferior vena cava. A pre-intervention fluoroscopic assessment was performed with the administration of non-iodinated contrast, in which we can also see the stenosis of the hepatic drainage. Therefore, a jugular and hepatic venoplasty with stent placement was performed. We have to remember that Bott-Carey syndrome is a rare condition in pediatric population, characterized by the obstruction of the venous hepatic drainage, the inferior vena cava, and in some cases, even both. The ultrasound findings are hepatomegaly with or without alteration in the liver parenchymal echogenicity, caudate lobe hypertrophy, and hepatic vein or inferior vena cava stenosis that can be associated with a thrombus, entailing signs of hepatic congestion with portal hypertension. The CT imaging will allow the visualization of this hepatic congestion and gives us an anatomic detail of the hepatic vasculature that is necessary for the planning of interventional procedures, such as angioplasty with or without stent placement. And even though the angioplasty or these procedures are only a temporary solution, they can help improve the overall prognosis of the patient while the patient awaits for the hepatic transplant that is the definitive treatment. And this is a picture of her patient after the procedure. She has shown a really good recovery and is now waiting for the hepatic transplant. These are the references used in this case. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Very interesting. So now we are moving to our next case from Chile, Dr. Fernanda del Campo from the Universidad del Desarrollo Clínica Alemana de Santiago. She's going to talk about from weight loss to woes, a liver abscess with an endobarrier.
Good morning. My name is Fernanda del Campo. I'm a radiology resident at the Universidad del Desarrollo Clínica Alemana de Santiago, Chile, and my tutor in charge is Dr. Fernando González. I have no disclosures, and the title of this work is From the Weight Loss to Woes, the Case of a Liver Abscess in an Endobarrier. I will tell you about the case of a 43-year-old man who consulted for a digestive discomfort, compromise of general condition, and early satiety. He also had a history of bariatric surgery performed 7 years earlier. His physical examination showed a slightly tender abdominal in epigastrium, so an abdominal ultrasound was requested. In this image, we can see a large hypochoic focal lesion with partially defined borders, sparsely vascularized in Doppler color mode, mainly involving segment 7 of approximately 30 by 8 centimeters due to suspicion of a lesion of a probable neoplastic origin, a CT scan of the abdomen and pelvis with contrast was requested. This selected image of the tomography confirms the presence of a predominantly cystic multiloculate lesion of approximately 13 per 8 centimeters with a thick hyperuptake wall, perilesional hyperemia in the arterial phase, and perilesional edema was confirmed, involving segments 6, 7, and 8, compatible with an abscess. Furthermore, in the small intestine, endovariate is identified with proximal end in the second portion of the duodenum and the distal end in the jejunum. The duodenal jejunal bypass is a device with malabsorptive effect of an endoscopic and reversible installation used to treat type 2 diabetes mellitus and obesity. It has a maximum withdrawal indication of 2 years from its installation. Our patient still had it installed 7 years later. It is a waterproof biopolymer tube anchored to the duodenal bulb with titanium hooks. This covers the duodenum and first portion of the jejunum, preventing the contact between the luminal contents and the intestinal mucosa, and the biliopancreatic secretions pass freely on the outside. It was drawn from the market due to its high rate of a complication of adverse effects. Among the most common mild types are nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, anemia, and migration of the device. And the most reported serious adverse effects are hemorrhage, perforation or tear of the mucosa, obstruction, and in lower incidence, abscess. It is believed that the physiopathology could correspond to ascending cholangitis or an occult perforation of the duodenum. The device was successfully removed endoscopically and the patient progressed favorably. This device has already been removed from the market due to its high rate of adverse effects and complications. Also, it has been recognized that the desired effect is achieved with the installation of the device. Its removal must be followed as indicated by the manufacturer's instruction that it after 2 years. Our patient had his complication probably due to the failure to remove it. These are my reference. Thank you so much.
All been really interesting cases. We have 3 cases left, so remember to tell your friends to be ready for the People's Choice Award. Coming up from Mexico, from Hospital Ángeles Mosel, we have Dr. Natalie Levin presenting right iliac vein to right ventricle stent migration.
Good morning. Thank you for joining me today. My name is Natalie Levin-Cohen and I'm a fifth-year medical student in Hospital Ángeles Mosel in Mexico City. My mentor is Dr. Jared Lazard-Rosenthal and we have no disclosures. Today, I will be presenting a case titled Right Iliac Vein to Right Ventricle Stent Migration. Let's dive right in. Our patient is a 37-year-old male with no family medical history. As of his medical background in 2020, he experienced right iliac vein thrombosis. To address this, he underwent a procedure in 2021 to have a stent placed in his right iliac vein. Following the procedure, he has been diligently taking Xarelto 10 milligrams daily as part of his treatment regimen. Aside from this, he has no other significant medical history. Fast forward to 2024. Our patient arrives at the emergency department presenting with dyspnea, hyperhidrosis, and chest pain. These symptoms immediately raised concern among the medical team. Therefore, diagnostic tests were promptly conducted. First, an electrocardiogram was performed, and in it, we can see a sinus rhythm, QRS axis of 90 degrees, heart rate of 125 beats per minute, P P-wave of 40 milliseconds, QRS complex of 140 milliseconds, QT 320 milliseconds, corrected QT of 462 milliseconds, with a suggestive pattern of a right bundle branch block. Negative T waves in T3 and V1 through V4, and a pattern of S1, T3, Q3, also known as a McGinn-White complex, both of which suggest a right ventricular overload. Subsequently, a non-contrast chest CT was performed in which we can see axial slices from the thoracic operculum up to a portion below both hemidiaphragms, right jugular vascular catheter with tip in distal third portion of superior vena cava, pericardial effusion, a hypertense tubular structure, and a bilateral laminar pleural effusion of right predominance of less than 10%. Remarkably, this object was identified as a migrated right iliac vein stent causing complications within the cardiovascular system. Given the severity of the situation, our medical team swiftly consulted with cardiothoracic surgery experts. After careful consideration, it was unanimously agreed that an urgent procedure for stent removal was imperative to mitigate potential risks to the patient's health. The patient was promptly transferred to a cardiovascular high specialty unit, where a team of skilled professionals successfully extracted the migrated stent. With this, our patient made a full recovery and there were no reported complications following the procedure. Even though the EKG of our patient presented a McGinn-White complex, a cardiac abnormality that refers mostly to pulmonary hypertension, it is important to emphasize that it is not pathognomonic of this pathology, as it only suggests a right ventricular overload. In conclusion, deep vein thrombosis is a potentially life-threatening condition that affects more than 300,000 individuals in the U.S. annually. Thrombosis of an iliofemoral vein accounts for approximately 25% of all lower extremity DVTs and is associated with an increased risk of pulmonary embolism. Percutaneous transluminal angioplasty has become an accepted technique in the treatment of aortoiliac occlusive disease, with success rates of 90 to 92% and primary patency of 55 to 72% at 5 years. Stent migration is a fairly rare complication, only having a 0.9% incidence with patients with iliac stents, but the morbidity and mortality of it is high, highlighting the need for continuous monitoring and swift intervention when necessary. Collaboration between medical specialties played a pivotal role in ensuring the best possible outcome for our patient. Thank you for your attention and engagement.
Thank you for this case. So now moving on to our next case from Brazil, Dr. Mateus Taborda from Hospital de Clínicas da Universidade Federal do Paraná. He's going to talk about communicating hydrocephalus in an immunocompromised patient.
Good morning. My name is Mateus Taborda. I'm a third-year radiology resident at Universidade Federal do Paraná. For this case, I was mentored by Dr. Bernardo Correa, and I speak on behalf of my colleagues from the Department of Radiology and Department of Infectology of our hospital, Complex Hospital de Clínicas, in Brazil. So, today I'd like to present a case of a 35-year-old male living with HIV. He was brought to the emergency department with symptoms for the past 2 weeks, including fever, behavioral changes, visual hallucinations, and paraplegia. His treatment for HIV was irregular, and his workup from 3 months prior to admission showed over 80,000 HIV copies and CD4 cell counts of 257 cells, thus confirming an immunosuppressed state by that time. He was also treating testicular and cutaneous proptosis with itraconazole over the past 2 months. Furthermore, the patient had a relevant history of social vulnerability, drug addiction, and he was homeless for the last 5 years. Lumbar puncture was performed in the admission and showed lymphocytic pleocytosis and hyperproteinuria. On the next day, brain MRI was performed. This first image is an axial flare sequence showing hydrocephalus with transepenzimal edema, as well as diffuse effacement of suicide. This sagittal post-contrast T1 shows the open cerebral aqueduct confirming the communicating hydrocephalus, as well as discrete and thin-layered enhancement of the pons surface. These findings are suggestive of leptomeningitis. The meningeal enhancement in the basal cisterns becomes more conspicuous in post-contrast flare sequences instead of T1, like in this figure, with maximum intensity projection. The enhancement can be seen at the arrowheads. As an additional finding, the patient had a small contrast enhancing granuloma at the left aspect of the pons. Image A shows one of the skin lesions the patient had with crusted plaques and a central ulcer. Image B is a photo of a sample obtained from the patient's testicle, showing the typical micromorphology of the sportrix with those tiny grape-like structures indicated by the black arrow. Further co-modeling gene sequencing confirms sportrix brasiliensis in this sample. So, sporticosis is caused by the fungus sportrix, either Schenke or brasiliensis, and it is endemic to Brazil. There are two main routes of infection. The first is skin lesions inflicted by thorns or plants, and is common in gardeners and farmers, so in the countryside. The second is more present in urban centers because domestic cats can also be infected and serve as reservoirs of the disease. Therefore, the main site of infection is the skin, but up to 8% develop the disseminated form. From this, up to 17% develop CNS symptoms, especially immunosuppressed patients. Chronic meningitis is the most common form of the disease in the CNS and has a mortality rate of up to 64%. Imaging findings may be absent, but MRI can show leptomeningitis, small enhancing granulomas, and communicating hydrocephalus. In our case, the patient was treated with lisosomal and deoxycholate amphotericin B, which is the standard treatment of choice, and symptoms improved after 1 month of treatment onset. As teaching points, I'd like to highlight that meningitis, hydrocephalus, and small granulomas may raise suspicions of CNS proticosis in patients living with HIV in the Americas with concomitant skin lesions. CNS proticosis may have severe forms and diagnosis should be made as quickly as possible. As an additional teaching point, I'd like to point out that post-contrast flare sequence raises conspicuity of the meningeal enhancement in MRI. These are my references, and thank you very much.
Okay, we're down to our last case. Remember, after this presentation, we will put a poll so that everyone can vote for their favorite case. This last case comes from Argentina. We have Dr. Samira Abraham from Hospital Luis Lago Maggiore, presenting complete invasive hydatiform mold and normal fetus.
Twin pregnancy, complete invasive hydatiform mold and normal fetus. I'm Samira Abraham. My mentors are Brunella Ronchi, chief of residence, and Peña Gustavo, chief of surgery. Institution, Westman, Mendoza, Argentina. Excuse me, my English is not very fluent, so I ask for your patience and understanding during this conference. We present the case of a 32-year-old female patient with a history of 4 pregnancies, 1 abortion, 2 cesarean sections. She arrived to a hospital to multiple episodes of metrorrhagia that subside spontaneously. HTC 28 beta indicated 1 million. An obstetric ultrasound scan was performed with showy uterus in raised side with multiple dichorionic diamniotic pregnancy. In this image, see one hexagonal sac contains fetus of 12-4 weeks of gestation, and the other hexagonal sac contains heterogeneous mass with multiple microcysts giving the appearance of the snowstorm scene or bunch of grapes scene. Feeling suggestive of a complete mood. Afterwards, due to the finding, a magnetic resonance of the abdomen and pelvis was performed. In this image, we see a magnetic resonance of pelvis, coronal T2, image show a left gestational sac occupied by tissue with multiple microcysts and right gestational sac occupied by fetus. Magnetic resonance of pelvis T1 with contrast axial image show a left posterolateral gestational sac occupied by tissue with multiple microcysts with no fetus, feeling like it to complete invasive idatiform mode. Magnetic resonance of pelvis sagittal T2 confirming posterior myometrial invasion, extending to a left posterolateral wall approximately 20 millimeters for the OCA. Treatment. It was assigned to terminate the pregnancy and perform a hysterectomy. The postoperative period passed without significant complication. In this image, we see PS of hysterectomy in correlation with the radiological finding. Discussion. Gestational trophoblastic disease is an uncommon disease with malignant potential. It's almost always curable. A combination of a clinical history, laboratory markers, and imaging findings are key to reach a proper diagnosis. Therefore, the radiologist plays an important role in the early diagnosis, decreasing the morbidity and mortality of molar pregnancy, as well as in the studying and follow-up of patients. Bibliography, and thank you very much.
Okay, now we are ready for the intermission. I will hand it over to Hansel Otero.
Hand it over. No, thank you very thank you to all the participants. Those were awesome cases. We've been busy here scoring and discussing each case as they are shown. We do need some time to discuss like who will the winners be. But just remember that you are it's our poll live. The you're gonna see the pop-up that is the poll for you to vote on. And we are going to have, remember that we have a prize for people's choice. So vote for the best case. If you don't have a clear favorite of your best case, I guess that you can vote for your friends. But so anyway, give us 5 minutes. We're going to leave you with some good music and while we deliberate on these sites. Thank you, guys. Ok, ahora sí. Ah, pero necesito un papel para leer, porque si no me equivoco. No, lo tengo aquí. Ya tenemos los ganadores. Bueno, primero que todo, darle las gracias a todos los que estuvieron con nosotros. En algún momento tuvimos 180 participantes o algo así. Entonces, gracias a los que nos acompañaron de todas partes de Latinoamérica. Porque esto dice unmute myself, ya yo me unmute. Ponemos aquí que estoy hablando en inglés, listo. Ok, entonces tenemos los premios y vamos a empezar con el tercer lugar. Y el tercer lugar fue me encantó este caso. El tercer lugar va para el doctor Carlos Almeida, de Ecuador, y el caso fue right upper quadrant pain, hepatomegaly and pleural effusion. identifying common radiological signs of dengue. Un caso excelente y además demasiado a tiempo porque vemos más y más casos de dengue viniendo de la región. Felicitaciones. Entre un ganador y otro, para que vean que todos estábamos aquí disfrutando de sus casos, de izquierda a derecha, para mí. Santiago y Mónica, que están presentando los casos. Sydney, que estaba manejando la computadora y los scores. Y la doctora Mónica Galeano, visitándonos desde Argentina y sirviendo de juez invitada. I realize that I said that in Spanish, so anyway, but the names are the same. Santiago, Monica, Sydney, and Monica are here with us. So anyway, for the second place, we have another awesome case. This case came from us, from Argentina. Dr. Samira Abraham, twin pregnancy, complete invasive hidatidiform mole and normal fetus. Felicitaciones. Hoy, porque no me da tiempo, pero ven ahí en las cámaras, la otra mitad. Tenemos a Alejo, Yadel, Mohamed y María Clara. María Clara también de Argentina, visitándonos, sirviendo de jueza. Y Mohamed, Yadel y Alejo en, no sé, en los teclados, digamos. Ok. Como hablé mucho, se me fue la imagen. Y tenemos que anunciar el People's Choice Award. This is an award that we give or that the audience gives to their favorite case. And this case goes to Dr. Primero. I need to say first that it's from Argentina as well. And it's going to Dr. Ramon David Perez Rojas in another case of dengue diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. Congratulations. And the winner is for the first place. Remember that the first place comes with a $1,000 cash award that we will contact the winner to make it happen. And in this third edition of the Latin American version of the case competition, the seventh case competition overall. We're happy to announce the winner is from Chile and is Dr. Pamela Romanque, that sees beyond lung and liver. Congratulations. That was the awesome case of hidatid cyst inside the heart. I've never seen anything like that, and most people apparently haven't either. Congratulations to all the winners. And I want to take the last minute before we leave you with the announcement in the slides and more good music. First, I want to ask to the 140 or so of you that are still here listening to please give feel the feedback that is going to appear in your screens. It's important to us to know how we're doing, what you would like to see, or what you would like us to do different or better. And the second part is again to thank all of our partners. This has become a tradition and we have a lot of fun doing it. It's always a good time looking at all the cases that come from the region, looking at all the presentations. This time we had over 50 cases, so we look at your abstracts and look at your images. There were awesome cases there as well that didn't get to present today. But we really appreciate your commitment and your engagement. And then we also want to obviously thank the guest judges that were here, the guest speaker that came early to talk to us, and all the team, the global team at the Global Center, at Penn Radiology, and at CHOP Radiology that make it possible for this to happen. Thank you very much, guys, and enjoy the rest of your day.